To run the, let's say, reserve funds, you know, for the rainy day. Is that your proposal?
Certainly.
Yes, because Kingsley, yeah. River State has, you know, savings, I recall. I don't know
well,
if it's...
Well, that was the point that came up during the Commission of Inquiry. We don't have the opportunity of going into all of those details. Well, the former governor, of course, you know, was probed by the Judicial Commission of Inquiry.
Okay.
And they said the value in the balances, you know, dropped, and of course the governor indicated that, of course, there was approval by the State House of Assembly for them to deal with that. But that's a point that I would like also return to with Mr. Uche Oji. Mr. Oji, you talked about the areas of intervention with regard to infrastructure. Well, you mentioned power, you mentioned agri, you also mentioned motorways. Now, there's been a lot of hot air, you know, about precisely the value of investment put forward by the Sovereign Investment Authority with regards to, say, motorways.
Sure.
Confusion, for instance, about the Lagos-Ibadan Expressway. Confusion, yeah. For instance, about the second Niger Bridge.
Sure.
Where are we? What is the status of your participation in this project?
Sure, sure. Thank you very much. I think Motorways has indicated interest in two projects. The first is the second Niger Bridge. The second is the Lagos-Ibadan Expressway. With regards to second Niger Bridge, we are still at the project development stage. And there are many aspects to getting a PPP done. Lots of studies need to be carried out. The project has to be designed. The cost has to be competitively reviewed before we feel comfortable. And then we need to do a bankability study and be sure that this is something that if you bring private capital into it, you can actually get the money back. Subsequent to all of that, you now do a concession agreement with the government. And then you can go fund the project and then build the project. So we took on the role of developers, co-developers. And again, on the infrastructure side, we can either sponsor a project, we can co-develop a project, or we can just be investors, in which case somebody else develops and we just invest and monitor investment. Second Niger Bridge was one where we became a co-developer and we were responsible for everything from environmental and social impact assessment. We had to do that. You need to understand, if you build this, what does it do to the communities around?
Mm-hmm.
We had to make sure the government paid adequate compensation to the people whose lands were going to be occupied. We had to make sure that the project was actually properly designed and costed. So we had to hire external engineering consulting firms to review the design, review the cost, give us advice. And you have to hire a whole bunch of legal, financial, environmental, traffic study, all of those things. So that's the development process. So we have done all of that, and that cost the consortium, which is of which NSI is a participant, $2.2 million to actually $1.96 million to get us to this point. Before even we did all of that, we did due diligence, which cost about $247,000 to decide whether we're even going to do this or not. So we're still at the development stage. We haven't even signed a concession agreement. However, the government decided to start what they called early works, which is, you know, pre-piling some structural projects. We said, okay, we will have to supervise that because we will be the concessionaire eventually. So that, for that, the government has spent 10.3 billion naira, properly audited, accounted for. And if you go there, you'll see what has been done. A lot of piling work has been done inside the water. Some substructures is coming up, superstructures coming up. But we have not reached financing close yet. The objective is to get to financing close by the middle of next year, by which time the real work will start. And from that moment, it will be 4 years to completion, which was why I gave the date 2020 to when the project will be completed. It's a big project. It's not a joke. It's a big project. It's 11.9 kilometers, three lanes going, three lanes coming. That's what we're responsible for. In an area where the water level rises and falls as high as 12 meters between dry season and rainy season, it's a complex project. So, but where we are now is just the development stage. Some early works have been done, but financial close will be middle next year, and then we'll start to push on.
Well, I'm wondering,
on Lagos-Ibadan.
Before you get to Lagos-Ibadan, I would like you to also take that because of the public interest factor in these projects. Let's get it clear. Former President Goodluck Jonathan and the former Minister of Works, as well as others, when they went for the groundbreaking ceremony or flag off, indicated that the project would take 48 months, and I'm sure some persons already started counting from the day that groundbreaking ceremony took off. But are you suggesting now that until the financial close in the middle of next year, we cannot begin to count 48 months?
Well, absolutely. I mean, the truth is, it's a complex construction. So, if you look at what the president said and what we are saying, obviously the difference is, flag off is one thing. At the point of flag off, people who actually, we're not part of the flag off, right? So you didn't see us there. When it became our job to develop it, we're giving you the realistic timeline, which is maybe 1 year more than the government had initially indicated when they flagged off. The reality is that these things are, frankly, my opinion is neither here nor there. The reality is when we get to the financial close is when I can say, right, I'll announce to you the money is completely ready, we start.
All right, thank you, Mr. Oje.
I'll address Lagos Ibadan. The funny thing is that Second Niger Bridge, we had not even made an open public commitment to how much we were going to invest because we're still getting to financial close. Depends on how much we get from other people, AFDB, if they're interested in the project and we work with them and all that. They've been supporting us, by the way, on the project. Let's be open on that. There are a few other people that will have to get involved before we decide how much NSIA in itself will invest. Lagos Ibadan, we are not the developers. We're not even the sponsors. The developers, what we said was to the developers, we said, we will invest. And we made it public that our commitment to that project was $100 million as investment to the project. Lagos Ibadan will be probably one of the most profitable roads I've ever seen because of the traffic on that road, even in its current state.
Mr. Oje, thank you. For Nigerians, for the lay Nigerians like us, if we can't use a project, it's not done yet. So Mr. Usman, you ADB, it's partnering the NSIF in the whole investment drive. In what ways right now, because Nigeria is in dire need of capital projects, in what ways can we use the SWF to do this?
Well, the SWF has already identified this critical project, which we found to be financially rentable, in the sense of having high rentability for the project to bring the ADB to create appetite on our part. So the Second Niger Bridge in particular, we've been working with them, and our private sector department is in the process of coming in as an investor. So
we in the process?
In the process, because we've been basically talking as we examine the viability of the project. But it go beyond this. The bank has done two things to support this kind of activity. We have set up a PPP advisory hub here in Abuja in my office. The purpose of that hub is really to help provide the technical and policy advice to really structure this PPP undertaking. The second initiative we have, which is taken at the corporate level, was to set up the African Legal Support Facility. This is really when it came to the stage of negotiation so that the bank can provide the support needed for the government to undertake this complex legal negotiation to set up the PPP transaction. Mm-hmm. So the NSIA has been the key partner for the bank, particularly at the time where we are increasingly shifting our operation toward infrastructure delivery in this country. We have our own study that showed that the gap for Nigeria over the next 10 years for the country to meet the 2020 objective is about $350 billion over the next 10 years. So this is why we've been clearly working with initiatives like Sovereign Wealth Fund, even setting investment fund outside this kind of structure to be able to quicken the delivery of infrastructure in this country.
All right, Mr. Dore, thank you very much for your comments. Let's return to our Lagos Network Center, where Bolaji Ogunseye has been with us, and of course, the development economist. Bolaji, let's take a look at this. There are many areas, crying for intervention. The Sovereign Investment Authority already has ticked off those areas where it's seeking to intervene: power, agri, and motorways. Would you have a shopping list for the investment authority? And perhaps just before you roll out your shopping cart, maybe I should just add the Ajakota Steel Complex.
Thank you very much. I really was going to say to Mr. Oji that great work they're doing, but we should, I notice very often when we do all these macro development things in Nigeria, that there tends to be too much of the attention paid to what I call the higher end segment of the economy, you know, all these high and barrier to entry investments where you need, you know, millions of dollars and things, and that's great. But I would personally suggest that the NSIA should look seriously at opportunities to help build the bottom of the pyramid economy, the BOP economy, for all sorts of reasons. I don't have to go into that now. He will know readily the importance of building that foundational economy, which is your about your most serious route to build a middle class from the bottom. And also to think seriously of using some of the funds in the area of investing locally in helping to diversify the economy now that we are having all these problems. Even if we're not having all these problems, oil is something we should have been doing. So they have to think seriously of that as well, especially for areas where you might have medium scale businesses, youth who might gang together, have business ideas which are not sort of non-oil businesses and things, so that you can start looking at possibility of making available to such investors, stakeholders, seed money to start medium, even small businesses, but you know, reasonably scaled small businesses, which will help push the economy into other sectors that we don't do now. But having said that, an area of concern to me is your investment in ongoing federal infrastructure or state infrastructure projects. What I'm concerned is, you did address it, but I just want to be sure that we're very clear about that, that you do not invest money, you know, and I have confidence that you may not, in federal projects, state projects, even local government projects, which are overpriced. You know, it's the major problem we have of, if you like, the cost of governance in this country. Most of the leakages are happening in especially physical infrastructure. Road constructions per kilometer, bridges, all these things are heavily overinflated per kilometer. We know that. It's all across the country. So I like to feel comfortable that as you go into Second Niger Bridge, Lagos-Ibadan Expressway, by the way, these are two projects that I understand the president has put on hold just to look at the costing. So I like to feel comfortable that as NSIA goes into co-funding, co-sponsoring, participation in those kinds of projects, and I mean physical infrastructure projects, especially roads, bridges, construction of housing projects and things, they want to be sure that they would not go with our money into any of these projects with the states or even the federal government if these projects are overinflated. Then the last point I want to make is about development of the human asset. I haven't heard enough about development of the human asset. Please make sure some of your money goes into building skills. Robotics is going to take over the world very soon. We should be thinking of building robotics engineers, robotic technicians, robotic designers, robotic, you know, repairers and all of this. So think of that area as well. Investing your money in human asset development.
Right, Mr. Bolaji Ogunseye, by the powers conferred on Kingsley and I, as anchors of this program, we confer on you the title doctor. So go out there and get your PhD, Dr. Ogunseye. We thank you very much for joining us on the conversation this morning. All right, thank you very much, Mr. Bolaji Ogunseye, a development expert, speaking to us from our Lagos Network Center. This is Good Morning Nigeria. Kingsley, you've got the last question.
Hey, well, that's right. Just to return to Mr. Oji. Mr. Oji, you listened to the points articulated by Bolaji Ogunseye before we signed him off. Perhaps you would like to respond. I have a concern. When he says, take care of or focus attention on the bottom of the pyramid, that's the phrase he used. I mean, is this to get the sovereign wealth fund into some micro lending function? That's one. Secondly, if you're having to focus on other areas and you don't have major targets, are you going to? Don't you run the risk of being, again, we saw it in this country, being called a parallel government? Sure. That's the way PTF was described more than 20 years ago.
Sure.
Third point, you had a spat not too long ago with the Edo State Governor Adams Oshiomhole. Is the matter resolved?
Is there any money missing, to put it point blank?
Yeah, I think the matter is largely resolved with His Excellency, the Governor of Edo State. There is no money missing. Look, we can have a debate as to whether you made the right investment or the wrong investment, but money missing, the processes we have designed will make it almost physically impossible. And here's the reason. I cannot sign an expense by myself. My ESCO cannot sign an expense not approved by the board. None, not one naira. And even then, if it's above 20 million naira, we go back to the board. So that's process. And obviously, there's a quarterly audit, there's an annual audit, all of those things make sure that the process is adhered to. Now, and I actually just call him Professor, you know, Bolaji Ogunseye. I think, you know, all his points are fantastic on so many ways. Let me start with the issue of addressing the issue, people at the bottom of the pyramid. And your interpretation of it as to whether we're going into microfinance lending, we can't. There are only 21 people in the Sovereign Wealth Fund staff.
21?
Only 21 people. So we really cannot get into anything. But there are ways to address those. You create institutions and fund institutions that can address people at the bottom of the pyramid. So one of the things we have done is we are the biggest investors in the Nigeria Mortgage Refinancing Company, which is supposed to help bring down the cost of mortgages. It is still starting, but I hope it becomes effective, because that way you can bring down the cost
of mortgage refinance. It was launched last year.
It has started. We've done our first round of refinancing, and I think that will bring down the cost of mortgages and help people, you know, get access to homes. And this is targeted at people who can afford it. The second is Development Bank of Nigeria. We're one of the sponsors of that, which will now help create credit for people in the SME. We can do those things.
Mr. Oji, we'd like to thank you. We'll just take a last question from Mr. Ndanusa.